From New York, this is Democracy Now!
We the people have decided we don't like billionaires buying our elections. We the people, we've decided we don't like voter suppression.
In a pair of major rulings, the Supreme Court guts more of the Voting Rights Act while making it easier for billionaires to secretly bankroll campaigns. We'll speak to Ben Jealous of People for the American Way. Then the family business of Donald Trump faces criminal charges for operating a 15-year tax fraud scheme. The company's chief financial officer has surrendered. Could this lead to charges against the former president? We'll speak to Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist David K. Johnston. Then to Minnesota to look at the indigenous-led resistance to block the Enbridge Line 3 pipeline.
Of land, the theft of labor lie at the foundations of this country. We all know that to be true. We see some of the most vulnerable people of this place who are on the front lines. Black, brown, indigenous, young, queer. There are no sacrifice songs. There are no sacrifice people.
We'll speak to Tara Hauska, founder of the GNU Collective. Plus, we'll look at leaked documents showing South Dakota may deploy the National Guard to suppress land and water defenders resisting pipeline construction. In addition, the South Dakota governor plans to take money from a Republican billionaire to send the National Guard to the U.S.-Mexico border. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The U.S. Supreme Court has gutted what's left of the Voting Rights Act by upholding two racially discriminatory voter laws in Arizona. Thursday's 6-3 ruling by the court's conservative majority will make it harder to challenge new voter suppression laws by being pushed by Republican state lawmakers across the country. In her dissent, Justice Elena Kagan wrote, quote, "What is tragic here is that the court has yet again rewritten in order to weaken a statute that stands as a monument to America's greatness and protects against its basest impulses. What is tragic is that the court has damaged a statute designed to bring about the end of discrimination in voting," Kagan wrote. In a second major ruling Thursday, the Supreme Court struck down a California law requiring nonprofit organizations reveal the names of large donors to the state. The case was brought by the Americans for Prosperity Foundation, a right-wing group founded by the Koch brothers. Election law experts predict the ruling could lead to challenges of campaign finance disclosure laws and a surge in dark money spending on elections. The Trump Organization's chief financial officer, Alan Weisselberg, surrendered to the Manhattan District Attorney's Office Thursday, charged with grand larceny for avoiding taxes on $1.7 million in perks he did not report as income. His arraignment came as District Attorney Cy Vance also filed criminal charges against the Trump Organization, accusing it of operating a 15-year tax fraud scheme. Weisselberg pleaded not guilty. He was ordered to surrender his passport and was released without bail. His lawyer said the case against him and the Trump Organization is politically motivated.
In 244 years, we have not had a local prosecutor go after a former president of the United States, or his employees or his company. And that is a— That is a significant line to cross.
Weisselberg could face up to a decade in prison if convicted. Many legal experts are speculating prosecutors targeted him with the hope he'll flip and help investigators and other ongoing probes into the Trump family business and possibly former President Trump himself. We'll have more on this story later in the broadcast with Pulitzer Prize-winning investigative reporter David K. Johnston. The World Health Organization warned Thursday the African continent faces an unprecedented third wave of COVID-19 cases. More than a dozen African nations have reported their highest rates of deaths and new infections since the start of the pandemic, with more than 650,000 new cases recorded since May 3rd. With testing in short supply and just 2% of Africa's population vaccinated, the true toll is likely far higher. In Johannesburg, South Africa, healthcare workers say hospitals are once again on the brink of collapse, with the fast-spreading Delta variant driving most new cases.
We don't see dead people. The funeral services see dead people. We see death. That's the difference. We see death happening. We try to get to the patients in time, but unfortunately, at certain times, we can't get to them in time.
Venezuela's begun mass vaccinations using Cuba's Abdala vaccine, which Cuban researchers say is more than 92% effective at preventing COVID-19. The Biden administration's refused to share vaccines with Venezuela, where officials blame harsh U.S.-led sanctions for delaying critical supplies needed for Venezuela's vaccination drive. Canada continues to bake under a heat dome that shattered all-time temperature records, with heat warnings in effect all the way from British Columbia to Ontario. Between Wednesday and Thursday, meteorologists logged an unprecedented 700,000 lightning events in Western Canada, driven by pyrocumulonimbus clouds from wildfires. The lightning strikes, in turn, sparked new blazes. They followed Canada's all-time record high of 121 degrees Fahrenheit set in the town of Lytton Tuesday. The town was almost completely destroyed Wednesday by a wildfire. In Greece, authorities closed the Acropolis to tourists Thursday as a scorching heat wave brought temperatures of up to 110 degrees Fahrenheit. And in Russia, a Siberian village known as the coldest inhabited place on Earth is baking in record heat with a high temperature of 89 degrees Fahrenheit. Siberia's heat wave is rapidly melting permafrost, releasing huge stores of methane, a powerful greenhouse gas. House Speaker Nancy Pelosi has named Mississippi Congressmember Benny Thompson to chair the House Select Committee investigating the January 6th insurrection at the U.S. Capitol. Six other Democrats will serve on it, including impeachment managers Zoe Lofgren, Adam Schiff, and Jamie Raskin of Maryland.
We need to figure out who organized the violence on January 6th. How did they organize it? And why did they organize it? What were the purposes of the different critical actors who were present on that day?
Speaker Pelosi also said Republican Congressmember Liz Cheney will serve on the January 6th committee. Cheney was one of just 10 House Republicans who voted to impeach Donald Trump for inciting the mob that attacked Congress. House Minority Leader Kevin McCarthy said he was shocked that Cheney accepted Pelosi's invitation and suggested Republican leaders might strip her of her House committee assignments. Attorney General Merrick Garland has ordered a halt to all federal executions while the Justice Department conducts a review of its policies and procedures on capital punishment. In a memo dated Thursday, Garland cites the, quote, arbitrariness in its application, disparate impact on people of color, and the troubling number of exonerations in capital and other serious cases. Attorney General Garland also ordered a review of the lethal injection drugs used to kill condemned prisoners. The Justice Department, however, has not changed its position that convicted Boston Marathon bomber Dzhokhar Tsarnaev should remain on death row. Beginning in 2020, the former Trump administration carried out a killing spree of 13 death row prisoners after then-Attorney General William Barr ordered the first federal execution since 2003. In Afghanistan, the U.S. military has left Bagram Airfield after nearly 20 years, a key center of command in America's longest war. An Afghan official said U.S. forces did not coordinate the departure with local authorities, resulting in a period of looting at the airbase before Afghan forces took over control. As the U.S. winds down its withdrawal from Afghanistan, at least 650 troops are expected to remain to secure the U.S. embassy in Kabul. Meanwhile, Taliban forces have taken control of dozens of districts in recent weeks. In Ivory Coast, a court sentenced 10 nationals of Burkina Faso to one decade in prison for trafficking children and forcing them to work on cocoa plantations. The group trafficked at least 40 children between the ages of 10 and 17 years old. The Ivorian prosecutor said the conviction is part of a shift in how the legal system treats such crimes.
Ça peut vous dire aussi que la justice We want to say that Ivory Coast's justice system is changing. We are breaking away from impunity for good because our people need to understand that our children's place is in school and not in the fields, not in quarries or in gold mines.
But many international corporations continue to be shielded for their role in child trafficking and slave labor. Last month, the U.S. Supreme Court ruled in favor of Nestle and Cargill, dismissing a lawsuit because the abuses took place overseas. The case was brought by six men trafficked to the Ivory Coast from Mali as children to work on plantations. In Turkey, thousands took to the streets as the government officially withdrew from the Istanbul Convention, a landmark international treaty aimed at preventing gender-based violence. Turkey was the first country to sign the convention when it was ratified 10 years ago. This is a protester in Istanbul, where police deployed tear gas on some of the demonstrators.
I am sure women are exposed to violence, rape, and abuse elsewhere in the world. But in the end, they know that those people will be punished. There will be a deterrent punishment, and the state will protect women. But I cannot say this here. There is nobody to protect me, and this is really awful.
At least 300 femicides were recorded in Turkey last year. More protests are planned this weekend. Back in the United States, the NFL has issued a $10 million fine to the Washington football team following a probe into widespread sexual harassment, which was perpetrated by the team's managers and executives. The NFL found repeated instances of bullying and intimidation, with many women employees reporting harassment and a lack of respect while at work. The reports of misconduct date back as far as 2004. The Boy Scouts of America has reached an $850 million settlement with tens of thousands of people who are sexually abused as scouts. It's the largest settlement of a child sexual abuse case in U.S. history. More than 84,000 people have joined lawsuits against the Boy Scouts with claims that sexual abuse was an unspoken norm within the organization since the 1960s. And in Canada, protests and vigils replace many of the usual festivities marking Canada Day following the recent discovery of graves and remains of First Nations children at government-run schools. In Saskatchewan, protesters laid backpacks covered in orange handprints on the steps of the legislative building representing the unmarked graves of Indigenous children found near the Maryville Residential School in late June.
No pride in genocide.
In Manitoba, Canada, protesters toppled a statue of Queen Victoria in front of the provincial legislative building. Many Indigenous people in Canada already long rejected the annual July 1st holiday. Lawyer Laurie Idlout said on Twitter, quote, "Today I celebrate Canada's failure to eradicate Indigenous peoples coast to coast to coast. We are here. We are strong," she said. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. In a 6-3 ruling, the U.S. Supreme Court has further gutted the Voting Rights Act by upholding two racially discriminatory voter laws in Arizona. The ruling's a major setback for voting rights and comes at a time when Republican state lawmakers are pushing sweeping voter suppression bills across the United States. In her dissent, Justice Elena Kagan wrote, quote, "What is tragic here is that the court has yet again rewritten, in order to weaken, a statute that stands as a monument to America's greatness and protects against its basest impulses. What is tragic is that the court has damaged a statute designed to bring about the end of discrimination in voting," she wrote. In a statement, President Biden criticized the ruling, saying, quote, "In a span of just 8 years, the court has now done severe damage to two of the most important provisions of the Voting Rights Act of 1965, unquote. Legal experts say the ruling will make it harder to challenge new voter suppression laws in court. Just last week, the Justice Department sued the state of Georgia, saying its new voter laws discriminate against Black voters. In a second major ruling Thursday, also a 6-3 decision, The court struck down a California law requiring nonprofit organizations reveal the names of large donors to the state. The case was brought by the Americans for Prosperity Foundation, a right-wing group founded by the Koch brothers. Election law experts predict the ruling could lead to challenges of campaign finance disclosure laws and a surge in dark money spending on elections. Counterpunch editor Jeffrey St. Clair summarized the court's rulings by writing, quote, "In two decisions today, the Supreme Court restricted the ability to regulate the influence of dark money in politics and gutted voting rights. In other words, it made it easier to buy an election and harder to actually vote in one," he said. To talk more about these cases, we're joined by Ben Jealous, the president of People for the American Way. He's the former president of the NAACP and a professor of practice at the University of Pennsylvania. Welcome back to Democracy Now!, Ben. Let us start with the first 6-3 decision, because they both were, gutting Section 2 of the Voting Rights Act. Can you explain exactly what the laws were in Arizona that the Supreme Court upheld?
Well, the most important part here is what this completes. The Shelby decision gutted Section 5. Section 5 made it possible for the U.S. Department of Justice to stop discriminatory voter laws before they went into effect. This decision guts Section 2. Section 2 makes it possible to stop a discriminatory law after it's been proven to be discriminatory. And so what this completes is the gutting of the most important piece of democracy legislation created in our country. And what we should all be concerned about is that what this also sends a signal, both of these decisions together, is really that the true legacy of the Trump administration is not so much the insurrection on January 6th as it was the takeover of our courts. We now have 6 very conservative justices. They are stealing our democracy. They are hijacking our democracy from the top to aid and abet these Republican governors who have sought to hijack it from the bottom. And that's where we find ourselves. So what's most important here is that Section 2 has been gutted. Section 2 was, if you will, the last chance we had to really use the federal courts to stop discriminatory voting laws. Now, the good news is that we have the For the People Act, we have the John Lewis Voting Rights Act. Both are moving, and there's reason to be hopeful that both will be passed in this Congress. It does mean that Joe Manchin, it does mean that Kristen Sinema will have to find the courage to stand up and join their party in doing the right thing.
The New York Times describes one of the measures that the Supreme Court upheld requires election officials to discard ballots cast at the wrong precinct. The other makes it a crime for campaign workers, community activists, and most other people to collect ballots for delivery to polling places, a practice that critics call ballot harvesting, but is often used in places like on Native American reservations. Ben, can you elaborate?
Yeah, and it's also used with most commonly with senior citizens who are shut in. And it's, this is a kind of old tradition in our democracy. It is very safe. The Republican Party has for decades now been trying to make a specious argument about voter fraud. Every time there's an investigation, it's found that statistically there is zero. There is like one case here, 2 cases there out of millions of votes cast, but the impact on any election is zero. And so why are they doing that? Well, when you look throughout U.S. history, those who are pushing voter suppression have always talked about vote security to push vote suppression. They said that, for example, women should not be voting. This is back in the 18th century, the 19th century, the early part of the 20th century. Why? Because that would give a man with a wife 2 votes. honestly try that at home. Like, it was BS then, and they knew it, but they made that argument because they wanted to keep women from voting. Going way back, they said that white men who did not own land should not be able to vote because they were not tied to a place and they could steal elections wherever they went. Again, they are making these specious arguments to push voter suppression. The good news is that the majority of the people in this country, and I'm talking about by a level of about 80%, are opposed to voter suppression and are in support of the For the People Act, in support also of the John Lewis Voting Rights Act. And so the hope, our prayer has to be that Congress and the Senate will do the right thing. It seems like Joe Manchin is heading that direction. Kristen sent him as a co-sponsor of the bill. Now she just has to have the courage to actually make it possible for her to vote for the bill that she supports.
And very quickly, the whole issue of dark money in politics in California, nonprofits not having to reveal who their funders are, why this could so grievously affect elections.
Yeah, so, you know, this is really pushed by the Koch brothers. They are the ones who are, Charles Koch is leading the charge to attack the For the People Act that would require disclosure. He founded AFP that brought this lawsuit. They manufacture things that most of the country buys. And what they don't want you to know is that the Kochs stand directly behind efforts to suppress the vote. And so they're trying to keep that quiet. What's also concerning is that many of these groups train judges. And so you see the kind of boldness of their corruption, because frankly, when you go back in kind of any right-wing judge's history, they typically have been to one of these trainings. So you very likely had Supreme Court justices rule to keep quiet the list ultimately of the donors who paid for them to be trained to assist those donors and their companies like Koch Industries.
And finally, Ben Jealous, you have been a longtime anti-death penalty activist as head of the NAACP and more. I want to ask you about the news that the Justice Department is pausing federal executions while it reviews its policies. In a memo dated Thursday, Attorney General Merrick Garland cites, quote, arbitrariness in its application, disparate impact on people of color, and the troubling number of exonerations in capital and other serious cases. Garland also ordered a review of the lethal injection drugs used to kill condemned prisoners. Can you comment on this?
Look, it's good news. It gets us in line with every other Western democracy and most countries on planet Earth. The other thing is that we really have to really be concerned about poor people of all colors. When you visit death row, and I've been to many death rows, yes, they tend to be disproportionately people of color. They are almost exclusively people who are too poor to afford their own lawyer. When you go down the list of people who were likely innocent when they were executed in this country, virtually all of them were too poor to afford their own lawyer. This is good news for everybody who believes that whether you are rich or poor, black or white, male or female, or simply no matter what zip code you were born in, because there's great discrimination there too, that you deserve equal justice in this country and that we should lead the world in human rights. It's an embarrassment that we still have the death penalty in this country. Every other Western democracy has long since dispensed with it.
Ben Jealous, I want to thank you so much for being with us, president of People for the American Way, former president of the NAACP. Next up, the family business of Donald Trump faces criminal charges for operating a 15-year tax fraud scheme. Could this lead to charges against the former president? We'll speak to Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist David K. Johnston. Stay with us. This Child by Susan Aglukkaq. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The Manhattan District Attorney's Office has charged former President Donald Trump's family business with operating a 15-year tax fraud scheme by helping executives evade taxes by giving them compensation off the books. The company has been charged with criminal tax fraud, falsifying business records, and committing a scheme to defraud. The chief financial officer of the Trump Organization, Alan Weisselberg, was also charged with grand larceny for avoiding taxes on $1.7 million in perks that he did not report as income. Weisselberg surrendered Thursday and pled not guilty. He could face up to a decade in prison if convicted. Many legal experts are speculating prosecutors targeted Weisselberg with the hope he'll flip and help investigators in other ongoing probes into the former president's company. During arraignment Thursday, Prosecutor Carrie Dunn said, quote, to put it bluntly, this was a sweeping and audacious illegal payments scheme, he said. Prosecutors accused the Trump Organization of helping executives avoid paying taxes on fringe benefits, including cars, apartments, and private school tuition. We're joined now by David K. Johnston, Pulitzer Prize-winning investigative reporter who's followed Donald Trump and his taxes for more than 30 years, previously at The New York Times, now co-founder and editor of DCReport.org. His most recent book, It's Even Worse Than You Think, What the Trump Administration is Doing to America. So, David, can you explain what these charges are about against both Weisselberg, the CFO, and the Trump Organization, which is the Trump family business?
This indictment lays out a calculated scheme over 15 years to pay large sums of money, $1.7 million, to Alan Weisselberg that was not included in the compensation he reported for tax purposes. Also, for him to claim that he did not live in New York City when he did, which helped him evade $220,000 of New York City taxes over the period in question. And it shows that Donald Trump, while not named in the indictment, is all over the document in terms of actions he had to take, including in the very last count, the alteration of records just before the 2016 election to remove an indication of an illegal act.
This is Alan Futeras, a lawyer for the Trump Organization, criticizing the prosecutor's case.
People across the country, we believe, have heard of corporate apartments, have heard of corporate cars. All of this is on the books and records of the company. That's how they know about it. And so it's, in my view, my personal view, it's not appropriate. And quite frankly, it sets a precedent. I think in 244 years, we have not had a local prosecutor go after a former president of the United States or his employees or his company. And that is a significant line to cross.
So talk about that line to cross. And also, he said, the reason the government knows about all of this is we kept the books. But in fact, they kept two sets of books. Is that right, David?
They kept two sets of books, which is, of course, a classic sign of tax fraud. The prosecutors had to go to the U.S. Supreme Court twice to get access to these records. And fundamentally here, neither Donald Trump in the statement he issued through the Trump Organization or his lawyers are saying, we didn't do it. It's not true. What they're saying is, we're special and we're privileged. There's a man in Alabama serving a life sentence for stealing $9. There was a man in California sentenced to consecutive 25-year terms because he was broke and hungry and he stole a slice of pizza from some children. 55 years, and the U.S. Supreme Court said, that's okay, that's a reasonable sentence. But Donald Trump and the people around him believe that they shouldn't be subject to the law. It's okay, everybody does this, everybody doesn't do this. But what an awful position for someone who took an oath to uphold the Constitution and faithfully execute the law.
So The indictment alleges that Weisselberg evaded, more than $1.7 million in taxes over a period beginning in 2005. So instead of getting, you know, direct payment that he pays taxes on, he's getting his grandchildren's private school paid for. He's getting an apartment and other things. Can you talk about why this investigation took so long? And is this just a way to flip him to get to Donald Trump? And what do we know, since you've been investigating Trump for 30 years, about Donald Trump and his children?
Well, first of all, let me just correct something. The taxes actually come to $880,211. The $1.7 million is the income. And a big portion of it is city taxes in New York because Weisselberg claimed not to live in the city of New York when he did. The investigation took so long for a very simple reason. Donald Trump fought the release and examination of his records from before he was president. In fact, his lawyer, George Consovoy, told a federal judge that if Donald Trump actually shot someone on Fifth Avenue, you'll recall he said he could do that and not lose a vote. If he actually shot someone on Fifth Avenue, the New York City police would be prohibited from investigating that murder. His position here is entirely, I am above the law. I'm special. Now, the Trump children are not named in the indictment, but the older three are all executives of the Trump Organization. And there's every reason to believe that the future indictments, this is only the first indictment, not the case, will involve at some point the Trump children and perhaps Alan Weisselberg's son, Barry, for similar crimes. And there are hints of that in this indictment. Now, the effort by prosecutors is fundamentally to get Alan Weisselberg to break with Donald Trump after 48 years of working for Donald and his father. At this point, Alan Weisselberg, who's about to turn 74, is a wholly owned psychological subsidiary of Donald Trump's criminal mind. It will be very difficult for him to break with Trump. And the case currently pending, while he could get theoretically 15 years, there is no requirement of any sentence higher than probation. So I think it's reasonable to expect that Alan Weisselberg and his lawyers at the moment are pondering running the risk of a trial and a conviction and then a judge simply saying, well, go home, sir, and report to the probation department once a month. That suggests there will be other charges that will have much tougher penalties. And I think the record is increasingly showing that something I've been saying for about a year is going to happen. Eventually, there will be an indictment for New York State racketeering enterprise. The state has a RICO law like the federal government. It requires showing three felonies. This indictment shows numerous felonies. And it would allow prosecutors to have a judge appoint a receiver to take control of the Trump Organization as a criminal enterprise.
Well, before we end, can you, David, talk about one of your most recent articles, headlined, D.C. Report Uncovers a Huge Secret Tax Favor for Super Wealthy. And in that, tell us just who Charles Rettig is.
Donald Trump appointed Charles Rettig to be the commissioner of the IRS. He is the first person to hold that job who made his name and spent decades helping rich people avoid and perhaps evade taxes, and if they got caught, negotiating secret settlements that never hit the public record for the taxes they cheated the government out of. He has said that the actual tax gap in the U.S. is more than twice the official number. It's probably over $1 trillion. The government doesn't collect $3 trillion in taxes, so that makes it a huge number. And most of this is among very wealthy people who own their own businesses. What's happened now is that in the Trump era, they got an approval to expand the number of auditors for gift and estate taxes. And there's plenty of evidence of massive, massive cheating in gifts and estates after people die. But the new hires will not be lawyers. They'll get the same pay lawyers get. Effectively, the job is being downgraded from colonels to corporals, but at colonel pay. And these new hires will simply not have the legal knowledge, to take apart the complex, multi-layered structures that people like Charles Rettig have created so that billions of dollars appear to the IRS to be mere pennies. The Biden administration could stop this with one phone call. This whole scheme is based on the Trump administration's legal advice that you can't hire any more lawyers to do this work. All they have to do is undo that decision. I've repeatedly emailed the White House. They told me they didn't know anything about this, which isn't surprising. This is a scheme we uncovered. But they haven't gotten back to us about whether President Biden will, or his staff, will see to it that this is at least stopped until they understand what's going on, and hopefully permanently stopped, because it's just a big giveaway to the most aggressive efforts by people and their lawyers to avoid taxes, Amy.
Well, David K. Johnston, we thank you for being with us. We're going to link to that article at democracynow.org. David K. Johnston, Pulitzer Prize-winning investigative reporter, co-founder and editor of DCReport.org. The expose, DC Report, uncovers a huge secret tax favor for super wealthy. His most recent book, It's Even Worse Than You Think, What the Trump Administration is Doing to America. Coming up, we go to Minnesota to look at the indigenous-led resistance to block the Enbridge Line 3 pipeline. Stay with us. By Frank Wan. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. Resistance to construction of the Enbridge Line 3 tar sands pipeline continued Thursday in northern Minnesota as more than a dozen water protectors locked themselves to construction vehicles at two work sites and to the pipeline itself. Just last month, 179 people were arrested. 1,000 shut down an Enbridge pumping station for 2 days as part of the treaty people gathering. If completed, Line 3 would carry more than 750,000 barrels of Canadian tar sands oil a day across indigenous land and fragile ecosystems. This is a Line 3 water protector who locked themselves to a horizontal directional drill and were arrested on felony theft charges.
Being charged with felony theft by a company that is actively stealing our clean water, our clean air, and our livable future. The state and Enbridge want us to be afraid. They have the money, they have the manpower, they have the courts to do their bidding. They want to bully us into believing their narrative that what we're doing here is wrong. If you think things can stay the way that they are, or that oppressed people's responses to the daily onslaught of violence that is life in the so-called U.S. Is too extreme, then you have made yourself an enemy of a just and habitable future.
This comes as dozens of Hubbard County sheriffs also barricaded the camp where water protectors are staying. The Enbridge Line 3 tar sands pipeline has the backing of the Biden administration. And this week, indigenous leaders and climate justice activists blockaded access to the White House, calling on Biden to stop fossil fuel projects and invest in climate justice initiatives in his infrastructure plan. Meanwhile, two men working on construction of Enbridge's Line 3 oil pipeline have been arrested in Minnesota as part of a sex trafficking sting operation. For more, we go to Minnesota to speak with Tara Hauska, Indigenous lawyer and activist, founder of the Ginu Collective. She's Ojibwe from Kuchiching First Nation. Tara, welcome back to Democracy Now! Just lay out the scope of this protest and what it is that you're protesting with Line 3, what it represents to you and what you hope to accomplish.
Good morning, Amy. Thanks for having me back. So what we're at basically is a all-out ground fight, people giving everything they have to defend this beautiful place and to stand up for future generations. I have seen over 500 people now passing through the legal systems in Minnesota, over 500 arrests through the cold winter, through a pandemic. To put that in scope, there were 800 people arrested out in Standing Rock. So that's where we're at. Even though this resistance has not been 10,000 people, it has been something where we've seen young people especially really stepping up to the plate. This is their futures on the line. Seen 20-year-olds crawling into pipes when it's 0 degrees outside, literally risking their own safety to stand up for their own futures and for someone yet to come. This, to me, is an extension of the fight that's happening all over Mother Earth, protecting the last beautiful places, protecting the sacred, as you were talking about at the beginning of the hour. Climate crisis is ravaging Mother Earth. The decisions that we've made as humankind are coming back to us. And this fight is happening in the meantime for these places, while the decision makers are talking, while the policy change is being pushed, while you have President Biden talking about being a climate president. Line 3, Trans Mountain Pipeline, Oak Flat, all these other places that are fighting, the Fairy Creek blockades, it's happening all over Mother Earth that we are standing up and defending the sacred.
This is another water protector speaking from close to where you are right now, from the Line 3 resistance site.
We start like drilling on the rivers, you know, to touch a body of waters that are really important. It's an urgency to be here. This is important to be here, to put our bodies in the front line, to walk there, like we always say, with no fear, but with like the certainty that what we're doing is right. This is a struggle for love. This is a struggle for life, for people.
So if you can continue along the line of description that he's given, also, who owns Line 3? What's it supposed to do?
Enbridge owns Line 3. Enbridge plans to send almost 915,000 barrels a day of tar sands from Alberta down through the headwaters of the Mississippi River to the shore of Lake Superior. It plans to continue the expansion of the fossil fuel industry, the emissions equivalent of 50 coal-fired plants, and putting, just in this territory alone, over 800 wetlands, 200 water bodies, 22 rivers. That's what Enbridge seeks to contaminate with its tar sands. It is billing it as a replacement project. It is not a replacement project. It's a brand new pipeline and a brand new route. They want a new route because they want a new corridor. There is no pipelines in the places that we're talking about. There is nothing there. It is just pristine ecosystems. And that's what we're trying to protect. We are protecting the sacred. We are standing up for what's right. We have done so at enormous self-risk and enormous personal cost, but we do so because it is what's right. We are standing with the sacred, and we're willing to risk everything to do it.
You've been arrested. Can you describe that experience, and can you talk about the authorities and what they're doing, particularly dozens of Hubbard County sheriffs barricading the camp where water protectors are staying? But first, describe your experience.
Yeah, I was arrested back in the springtime. So myself and several other Native folks, including the one that spoke before, Victor, were in a sacred launch, and we were directly in the middle of a work site. We prayed, we sang, we shared prayers, and we were pulled out and we were arrested. Police then chose to cut apart our lodge after we were arrested. I was put into a kennel, I was strip searched, and when I was brought to Zoom court, they put us in belly chains. That's how they treated us, for misdemeanor charges. My experience has been that of many, many other water protectors who've been arrested throughout this struggle. And as far as the sheriff showing up at our doorstep on Monday, I mean, yeah, we're talking about egregious rights or egregious violations of just basic property rights. They attempted to say that because there's a county, there's a little parcel of county land, 150 feet of it, with an easement on it held by Winona LaDuke, actually, that we don't have a right of access to it, that they've closed the county land and we can't access her private parcel by vehicles any longer. We have to walk on foot. But then they sent in a riot line of police and no one was leaving. No one was getting in. So 12 people were arrested in our driveway on Monday.
And what do you say to President Biden? He's approved this pipeline. I mean, he put a stop almost immediately to the Keystone XL pipeline. But when it comes to another pipeline that you were one of the leaders in protesting, Dakota Access Pipeline in North Dakota, and Enbridge 3, he's still fully supporting them.
Yeah, and Dakota Access Pipeline is running illegally right now at this very moment. And how many lives did that take? How many lives did that irrevocably change? And the human rights crisis that was the fight at Dakota against Dakota Access Pipeline on the ground, the dog attacks and so many other egregious human rights violations that occurred there, and yet that pipeline is still running under a so-called climate president. The Biden administration has declined to intervene when it should, including in Line 3. There is a very clear road and pathway towards intervention, which is ordering a review of the water crossing permits issued under the Trump administration, all those wetlands I described, all those water bodies I described, to suspend this project and review those. So considering tribal cultural resources, considering climate crisis and climate emissions that come from this project, those have not been considered in the environmental impact statement that was done at the state level. That's what we're asking for. It's almost a playbook directly out of Dakota Access Pipeline resistance, which is order the EIS, at least do the review, and there's no way it's going to pass the test.
In your comments, as you alluded to earlier, about the weather catastrophe this country and Canada, not to mention the rest of the world like Russia, are experiencing right now, a town has been wiped off the face of the map in Canada. Lytton, Canada, created its own climate with the heat above 120 degrees Fahrenheit, leading to a fire that just engulfed this town.
Yeah, and so here in Minnesota, we're experiencing extreme drought. The rivers and lakes are incredibly low. We're talking 5 feet low. And then you have pump trucks all over rivers, including the Mississippi River, pumping out what Enbridge now proposes. Originally, their ask was for 540 million gallons of water that they call dewatering, where they pull it out temporarily and then try to put it back into the ecosystem because it is such a wet area. They had to apply for a variance, 5 billion gallons of water. That's what they plan on pulling out of the wetlands in northern Minnesota while we are in extreme drought. So there are pump trucks all over the rivers, all over the lakes, and they're pulling water out and loading into trucks and mixing drilling mud to drill under our rivers and expand the fossil fuel industry. I've seen rice beds that are completely bone dry and bare, and seeing something like that and knowing what's happening around the globe, knowing that right here in Minnesota, we set records almost every day of June because it is so hot. And here we are expanding the fossil fuel industry. Here is, you know, the mainstream society choosing to engage in self-destruction. That's what's happening, and it's happening in real time. And in the meantime, there are people who are pushing for something different, and we are risking everything to do it.
Tara, I want to bring a second person into this conversation. I want to go from Nemawag Camp, where you are in northern Minnesota, to South Dakota. This week, the Republican governor there, Kristi Noem, announced she's deploying 50 members of the South Dakota National Guard to the U.S.-Mexico border at the request of Texas Governor Greg Abbott. But there's a twist. The deployment is being paid for by billionaire Republican mega donor Willis Johnson, who lives in Tennessee. Some critics have accused Noem of turning the National Guard into a private mercenary force targeting migrants. Our next guest obtained documents that indicate this same force, the South Dakota National Guard, will be deployed to suppress land and water defenders resisting pipelines. We are also joined by Bruce Ellison, water protector and land back attorney in Rapid City. Can you talk about, Bruce, what these documents show that you've gotten a hold of?
Good morning, Amy. Thank you for having me on. Essentially, what seems to be evolving is not just the militarization of our police forces, but particularly the active deployment and involvement of National Guard troops in the suppression of resistance to fossil fuel industry and other activities. And that's aside from the private use that you referenced earlier. Where are we going with this? Essentially, the documents that we got had to do with plans for the now ended KXL pipeline and how the South Dakota National Guard was going to be the main force to ensure that the pipeline, 315 miles, was constructed and that they would be guarding not only construction operations, but also equipment, and interestingly enough, including the use of lethal force. So what we're finding is that—
Can you talk more about what that means? The South Dakota National Guard can kill people to protect a pipeline.
Essentially, yes, they can. It can be used to defense of others, of course, but also defense of property. And the standards have to do with if other means cannot reasonably be used to stop destruction of property or someone who's leaving, believed to have destroyed property, lethal force can be used. What's happening is that we look at an evolution from, say, Standing Rock, where the National Guard played a role. They manned checkpoints. They drove trucks around with food and other equipment. That has then evolved to current plans for the KXL pipeline, which would be active deployment. I mean, these would be not only so-called civil disorder forces, but they would be backed up by regular troops who would be armed with automatic weapons. This was deployed a little bit about a year ago around the protest near Mount Rushmore when Trump was visiting by land-backed people who were trying to raise issues, as I said, near Mount Rushmore. We saw that real first combination of the active use of the military from being in the back to being in the front.
So you have the first news that Governor Noem is boasting about, that she got a mega donor, Republican donor, billionaire donor, to pay for National Guard's people to be sent to the border. Will these people, the National Guard, use to protect pipeline and go after water protectors be paid for by the company?
Well, that's an interesting question, because South Dakota established what they called a peace fund and had required TransCanada to put up to $20 million into this peace fund to be used for anything having to do with construction of the pipeline. It's a slightly different form, but still we're talking about the use of our National Guard to support multinational hazardous transportation and extraction industries in the United States, particularly the fossil fuel industry. What's unique about the current situation with the private donor is, according to the Rapid City Journal, our local paper, he called up Kristi Noem and said, asked her if she wanted to send National Guard troops to the border because they have similar attitudes about brown and red people trying who were seeking asylum or who were refugees, and offered up to $1 million to help that happen for a 30 to a 60-day deployment. And there's discussion now about they're going to only be using volunteers. Who are the people within the Guard who are going to volunteer and want to go down on the border and engage in these kinds of actions to prevent people just seeking a better life or even their own survival? And so it's a very dangerous precedent. right-wing agenda, privately funded use of our National Guard essentially as cheap mercenary troops. They're not even being paid the what security contractors normally get, that $150,000 tax-free. They're being paid their normal minimum wage jobs, but they're working for a billionaire who has an agenda, like our governor, who has the same agenda.
So from South Dakota up to northern Minnesota, Tarahowska, is this the first you're hearing of this? Does it surprise you? And can you talk about not only the National Guard being used, but the role of U.S. Customs and Border Protection agents in dealing with the Line 3 water protector protesters?
I have to say, I'm not super surprised. Actually, there was just a bill, H.R. 1374, the Energy Policy and Security Act, that just passed the House. And it essentially provides both a method for private actors, private industry, to directly work with states and create energy security policy. And it also provides federal funding for states to create energy security plans, specifically around critical infrastructure, which includes pipelines and extractive industry. It seems like it's basically like responding directly to situations like the Enbridge Corporation here in Minnesota, which is engaged in a public safety escrow trust where it's paying our police directly to, it's incentivizing our police to target, harass, surveil water protectors and reimburse them for all the costs of doing so. That's why we see 50, 60 squad cars here on a dirt road. Blockading us in our driveway. I mean, they're getting paid by the company to do it. And as far as the National Guard and all that and the militarization goes, I mean, we've seen Customs Border Patrol drones over our camp for years. There's been Customs, Department of Homeland Security helicopters over protests. There's been Department of Homeland Security helicopters over our private property, our encampment. It's something where you're seeing a very concerted effort to surveil, harass, and target indigenous-led movement.
Before I ask you a slightly different question about what has happened throughout Canada, yesterday being the Canada Day protests, let me ask you about these sex trafficking charges. What do you know about them? Two men working on the Enbridge Line 3 charged with sex trafficking.
I know that it's the second sex trafficking ring that's been busted that's had Enbridge employees in it in the months that they've been here in our territory. I know that we told and warned the state, we warned the governor and Lieutenant Governor Peggy Flanagan that this would happen, and it did. A 30-minute training or even a day training to employees is just not enough. These people are here in our state. They're mostly from out of state. There's 5,000 mostly out of state workers here constructing Lane 3. They are growing increasingly aggressive. Actually, yesterday at the demonstration, one of the workers attempted to drive a vehicle running over protesters on site. These people are here to destroy the territory. They are not interested in developing relationships or being accountable to our communities because they're not.
Finally, the protests all over Canada Thursday on Canada Day following the recent discovery of graves and remains of First Nations children at government-run schools. Tara, you are Ojibwe from the Kochiching First Nation. Can you talk about this?
It is a it's a gut punch that I think a lot of us already knew. But it's hard still to see those numbers and to know all those lives and all those generations that are missing, all those voices and people that belong to us that were taken by the residential schools and by the boarding school era. I think it's a very stark reminder of what we have to come to terms with in terms of looking at the treatment of Indigenous people, both by Canada and the United States and around the world, the attempts to eradicate us and the continued efforts to do so through out-of-home placement of children and destruction of our land, our territories, theft of so many different aspects of our people.
Tara Hauska, I want to thank you for being with us. That does it for our show. Indigenous lawyer and activist, founder of the Ginu Collective, and also Bruce Ellison, water protector and land back attorney. I'm Amy Goodman. Have a good weekend. Be safe.